Hi, this is Dan Cortopassi of TSG Multimedia. Welcome to Model Railroading 101. As usual, I'm here in front of the camera, and John is behind the camera making me look good.
And making me look good, too.
Yeah. I think last time I said we were going to talk about equipment, and equipment is a huge topic, so I decided that it might be better to break it up. So today what we're going to focus on is freight equipment, specifically freight cars, and go through some of the most common types of freight cars and talk a little bit about how they're used.
All right.
So I thought we'd start with the type of car that most people know about, and that's the boxcar. And a boxcar is just that. It's a box on wheels. It has four walls, a roof, and a floor. And they can be used to haul just about anything. They have the advantage in that whatever they're hauling is inside and protected, at least in theory.
Right.
From the weather and weather and vandalism and whatnot.
Some hobo left the door open.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I don't have any models of the really old-time boxcars that were made entirely of wood. Those would have been starting in the 1800s and going on through the, you know, beginning of the 20th century. As cars got bigger, loads got heavier, trains got bigger and heavier, cars started to have more and more steel parts. Until they're pretty much all metal construction. But anyway, regardless of that, let's take a look at these first two. So the red GN car here represents a car that is partly wood construction. It has plywood sides. I'm not sure when these were built. This one has a stencil date on it of 1966, but that could be a repaint. I know during World War II, some cars were built as hybrids of wood and steel construction because of wartime rationing. I'm not sure if this is one of those, but in any case, this represents a car that's partly wood, partly steel. And this one represents a car that's all steel. These have been like running around in the steam era and into the 60s, maybe into the early 70s. The 40-footers were pretty much the standard size back then.
Oh, is that what this is, a 40-foot?
Yeah, these are 40-foot boxcars. And a lot of people that run steam will probably have fleets of these things running around. The older boxcars have roof walks on them. Those were banned, I think, in the 1960s. But way, way back in the day when they used to have vertical brake wheels on the really old cars that were made of wood and before air brakes, they used to have brakemen that would have to run along the tops of the cars and screw the brake wheels down when they wanted to stop the train. And they'd like run and then jump from one car to another.
Wow, it was a different world.
Yeah, imagine doing that in a snowstorm when the roof walk is all icy. You really don't want to fall off, especially not between the cars.
That could be messy.
Yeah. So eventually those things were banned, and so modern boxcars, you don't have those anymore. So these are 50-foot boxcars. They're a little bit longer, and these particular cars have build dates in the 1960s.
And they have no roof walks, like you said.
They have no roof walks. And the brake wheel is mounted lower. That's because they just, you know, people don't do that anymore. They don't get up there. They just, you know, the brake wheel is more within reach. They still have to get up on the ladder, but not, you know, go all the way to the roof.
Yeah, and I'm looking at these, and I hadn't noticed this before, but now I noticed it, that the ladders don't even go all the way to the roof anyway.
No, they don't.
Like they don't even need to.
They really don't want you up there.
Yeah.
So now the difference between, one of the differences between these two cars is that this is a regular height car, the Western Maryland car, and the Southern Pacific car is a high cube. So it's taller, and it can haul, you know, stuff that would be taller inside.
Or stacked higher, right?
Or stacked higher, yeah.
One thing that I have learned watching trains out on the real railroads, is that the higher cars like that have a white stripe across the top. And I've always assumed that that white stripe indicates, one, that it's a high cube or a high profile car, but that the bottom of the white stripe is what would be considered normal height. Is that correct?
I think that's how it works. Yeah.
Okay. So I guess that's a spotting feature then.
Right. So these are some even bigger box cars. This is a 60-foot high cube, and this is an 86-foot high cube.
86 feet?
Yeah. Now, one thing you need to keep in mind about freight cars is that the length is usually dependent on what they're carrying, because most modern freight cars can carry maybe 100 tons, give or take. Some of them rated a little less, some of them rated a little more, but I think it has to do with the axle loading.
Okay.
So generally, the longer the car, the lighter the stuff it's carrying.
Right. Well, that we talked about that once a long time ago, I think on a podcast, we were talking about passenger cars.
Right. Passenger cars can be long because people don't weigh that much as trains go.
Yeah, well, you know, you can't, unless you're in one of those Asian countries, you also don't stack people end to end and push them, you know.
No.
Load it.
No. But, you know, even at that, you know, it's a relatively light load. Now, a lot of these kind of, these big high cubes like this are often used for auto parts.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them were actually put in special pools of cars from different railroads that they would just run around to different factories. And some of them even had special loading racks so that they would carry, you know, sheet metal stampings or whatever. And they had quite a, I've read something about it, and it they had quite a system worked out for the whole thing. So anyway, so just keep in mind that some boxcars were used for special purposes like these, and other ones are more general. Another thing to look at with these have what's called plug doors.
Those open outward?
Yeah, these come out and then slide. And I mean, the model doesn't actually do that. But what that results in is a flush fit on the inside. So it's like the wall is just continuous.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the cars that have the sliding doors on the outside, you know, don't have that. So these actually have a better seal with the plug doors. So next I'll talk about refrigerator cars. And these are essentially a specialized type of boxcar that are used to haul perishable things.
Okay.
Like food, you know, frozen vegetables.
Sure.
You know, anything like that. And there's three different types here. These two represent the oldest type of cars, and these are what we call ice reefers. And they have hatches on the ends. This one here is an all-wood car. This would have been a really old car. And this one is a steel car. But in any case, they both work the same way. They used to have these ice docks, and they'd bring these cars up to them. It was like a platform that was with a deck about the height of the roof. And they had people up there who would take these big blocks of ice and, depending on the load, cut them into smaller blocks and put them in the hatches. And these cars have basically bulkheads on the inside so that the ends are separate from the interior. Uh-huh. And the ice would fill up, and that would keep the load cool. And they used to have to re-ice the cars periodically as they were traveling, you know, depending on how far they were going and how right. hot it was where they were going. And these cars could also be used as ventilator cars for loads that didn't necessarily have to be so cold, like onions or something. They could open the hatches and just let air roll, you know, flow through as the car was going down the track.
Right, maybe bananas or something like that?
Yeah, anything that didn't necessarily have to be kept at a really cool temperature, but they still wanted to keep it ventilated.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how those work, the ice cars. So these are mechanical refrigerator cars, and instead of ice, they have a refrigeration unit. This car would have been from, say, the 1970s, the PFE car, and it has a little refrigeration unit inside it on this end.
Oh, right down where that grill is, huh?
Where the grill is, yeah. And this other car, this is an ultra-modern day car. You usually don't see them this clean. They're usually tagged up with a bunch of graffiti. But
oh, vandalism.
Yeah. But anyway, this car has a refrigeration unit on the outside. It's kind of like the same kind they put on refrigerated truck trailers,
uh-huh.
But bigger.
Yeah, bigger.
And they're basically the same idea as the ice cars, except that instead of having ice in them, they have what amounts to a big refrigerator keeping the whole car cool. So these two are insulated box cars, and these don't have any internal refrigeration at all. How these work is they basically chill them at wherever they're being loaded.
Well, like inside a warehouse or something like that, maybe?
Yeah. And then they put in whatever they're going to put in them, and then they close them up.
Oh.
And they will stay cold for several days because they're insulated pretty well. You know, eventually they will warm up because they don't have anything making it colder as they're traveling around. So sometimes these are used, like this one was used to haul certain types of wood products that are better if they don't get exposed to the elements and lots of temperature changes.
Yeah, wood warps.
Right. And this one is what's called a beer car. So I assumed it was used to haul beer.
That's a good one.
Yeah. Now, one thing about these is that they pretty much look just like any other boxcar. So you really kind of have to know that they're insulated boxcars. They usually have plug doors because those seal better than the other kind. But not all plug door boxcars are insulated. So you just have to kind of know. Usually they will have there's a little code if you want to get technical. This one is an RBL, which says it's insulated. And this one is an XLI. So you know it's insulated, but...
Yeah, but that doesn't even make any sense. XLI? Like,
well, X is boxcar, and L mean, I don't know. There's little codes like that for all different types of freight cars. I don't want to get into that because it gets real complicated in a hurry. But anyway, you kind of just have to know.
Yeah, I got a code for you. Sounds like a bunch of BS.
So these are stock cars, which I guess you could think of as another type of specialized boxcar. And these were for hauling livestock. And as you can see, they usually have slatted sides.
Oh, so the cows can breathe.
Right. Now, they don't really use these anymore. I think Union Pacific had some livestock traffic up through maybe the early 90s. But I haven't been aware of any happening since then.
Yeah.
I think most of that business has gone to trucks. But back in the steam era, they certainly did. And so when they hauled livestock, they would, you know, haul them in something that looked like these. So these are tank cars.
Oh, yeah.
Something totally different than boxcars.
These are the scary ones, right?
Well, they can be.
Yeah.
Tank cars are basically used to carry liquids, and they can carry just about any kind of liquid. Now, old-time tank cars like this one tended to be built with a frame and a separate tank body, whereas the more modern cars like these are frameless. The tank body is actually structural.
Oh, so the tank is the frame.
The tank is, yeah, basically, yeah. So that's one way you can tell a more modern tank car from an older one. But like this one carries hydrochloric acid.
That could be scary.
Yeah, this one carries fatty acid. This one is for corn syrup. This one's liquid petroleum gas.
Those are the scary ones.
Yeah, and this is propylene. I'm just reading what it says on the sides. But yeah, I mean, now one thing to keep in mind with tank cars is that they generally only use them for one thing. They don't, like, they wouldn't use the corn syrup car to haul oil and then put it back in corn syrup service.
I would hope not.
Yeah. So, you know, they pretty much stick to one thing, you know, they use different cars for different loads. But, and again, the size of the car depends on the density of the material.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, fatty acids must be very dense.
They must be.
Is that fatty acid as in, like, you know, vitamin B stuff, or what are you talking about?
I'm not sure. That's what it says on the side of the car, so that's what I'm going by. So these are flat cars, and the most basic type is like this first one here, which is just basically like a big flatbed truck on rails.
Right? It's like a stakeside truck because it has pockets for...
They do. They have pockets, and they can put stakes there to help hold the load, and... You know, these can be hauled, used to be hauled just about anything, you know, pipe loads, tractors, you name it. And sometimes they even have special heavy duty ones to haul, like, you know, generators for power plants and things like that that would be too big to fit in a regular train car. So anything on a flat car is basically something that could be exposed to the elements and probably not get hurt. So this next car is what we call a bulkhead flat. And it's basically the same thing as this, only it has these bulkheads on the end, and that protects from shifting loads. Like if you had a load of pipe, you know, because there's slack action in the train and things like that, it'll keep the load on the car. The center beam flat is an evolution of the bulkhead flat idea with a beam running down the center. And what these are used for typically is wood products or building products like sheetrock, or a sheet lumber that they bundle, and they'll load them up and then they tie them down to the car. And that way it keeps the load from shifting front to back, and it also keeps it from shifting side to side.
I don't think I've ever seen one of these before.
Yeah, these are a little unusual. This is basically a flat car, just a regular flat car with this superstructure on it. And these were used to haul aircraft parts. This one obviously for Lockheed, but... They used to use these for different manufacturers of aircraft parts.
Yeah, here's a question, and I don't know if you'll know the answer to this, and I think I might be able to surmise the answer to this. because we talked about boxcars earlier, and those were things that, you know, you don't want your load to be exposed.
Right.
Why not just put aircraft parts into a boxcar? Is it because maybe it's too tall, so they had to, you know, like...
I think it had to do with getting it out.
Hmm.
These covers, I know in the model it's just one piece, but on the real ones, they came apart in sections, and I think they would basically take this off and then lift the aircraft wing out or whatever it was, and then put the cover back together and send it for another load.
So it's really for a large single piece, like a wing or something.
Right.
Oh, it says right on it, aircraft wing assembly. So,
right.
Yeah.
Right. So this is an 89-foot flat car, and this is what's known as a TOFC car, or a trailer on flat car, because they haul trailers, as you can see. And they're usually equipped with trailer hitches, and then they just have these cranes that will lift the trailers on and take them, you know, take them off again. There are also some 89-foot flat cars that either have been repurposed and had the trailer hitches removed or built that way to haul other things like windmill parts or long pipe loads or whatever. These are intermodal cars, and I've actually brought the same TOFC flat car back because it is also an intermodal car. This thing here is another type of car that carries a trailer. It's a little four-wheel car, just it carries one trailer.
Hmm.
So it's kind of, without the trailer, looks like that.
Don't think I've ever seen one of those in real life before.
Yeah, there's a few around. They also have a thing called a spine car, which looks kind of like these. I don't have a model of one, but they're usually articulated in sets of five or something like that.
They carry trailers like that?
Trailers, or sometimes they can put containers on them too. Sometimes they also put containers on these longer flat cars. So this is a well car, and these are pretty much used to haul containers. This one also has hitches on it, so it could actually have a trailer put in it as well.
Oh, yeah. Look at that.
Yeah. But it's basically just a car with a big empty space that's very low to the ground, and that allows them to have clearance to stack two containers, one on top of the other.
You see these trains all over
everywhere.
The place. Yeah. It's a very interesting thing, I think, to talk about just a little bit, because somehow, and I guess it's the evolution of shipping, right?
Mm-hmm.
Someone somewhere came up with this idea of using a container that could be used as a part of a trailer, like a box trailer on a truck, or loaded like this, and it's pretty ingenious.
Or
onto a ship,
on a ship. Yeah, they can take a load from somewhere in Asia, you know, drive it on a truck to the dock, put it on a ship, ship it to the States, put it on a train, send it to the East Coast, put it on a truck, and deliver it to its destination. And the thing never gets opened until it gets to its final customer.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
Yeah. So, and in fact, they even have specialized containers. Like this one here is actually a refrigerated container, serves much the same purpose as a refrigerated boxcar, but it's a container. So this is an articulated well car, which is basically the same thing as the single unit well car that we just looked at, except that it has multiple units and they share a common truck between each unit.
Hmm.
That's what the articulated means. And these are usually built in either 3-unit sets or 5-unit sets. So one thing about these, even though there's multiple units, it's considered one car as far as the railroad's purposes go.
Oh, so it would have the same car, the identifying number, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, all three units have the same number. They may be they may have an appended ABC or something behind it, but they will share the same number.
Yeah, I'm looking at it now, and it is. It's a DTTX 732958.
Right.
It's on all three units.
Right.
So, but I did want to look at that shared truck, because that's something that if this just rolled by and you weren't really paying attention, you'd miss that.
Yeah. Yeah, you gotta look for that. So these are log cars, and yes, I know these logs look terrible. These are the logs that came with this car.
They look like Slim Jims, Dan.
Yeah, I know.
Snap into it.
Anyway, we can take those off. This is a skeleton log car, basically, because it doesn't have much more than a center sill and these supports for the logs.
Yeah, there's no deck.
Yeah, there's nothing. This is one that's converted from a flat car by adding these log bunks. So this is a more modern type. But either way, they'll haul logs or pulpwood or what have you. So these are auto racks. And this one in front is basically an 89-foot flat car with the auto rack structure on top of it.
We see a lot of these around here, too.
Yeah. These come in two- and three-deck versions. The two-deck versions are for, like, trucks and SUVs, and the three-deck versions are for smaller cars.
Mm-hmm.
And then this one in the back is an articulated auto rack, which is a two-unit car.
Well, how do they get the cars in there?
They drive them in on the end. So this is a two-deck car, and what they do is they have these rolling ramps that they will put up to one of these, and then they just drive the cars in. These are hopper cars.
Mm-hmm.
And hopper cars are usually used to carry something that's granular.
Yes.
Like gravel or coal.
It says rock right on it.
Right.
Right? Ballast.
Yeah. And these have sloping insides that go down to these discharge gates, and they can be unloaded by opening the gates and letting whatever's in there fall out. So if you look, you can even see the little hatches at the bottom. These are covered hoppers. And these are pretty much just like hoppers, except they haul things that would get hurt if they were exposed to the elements or if they got wet.
Oh, grain.
Grain, yeah. Grain is one.
Any kind of seeds, right?
Yeah.
Salt, maybe?
Cement.
Yeah. Any powdery stuff, right?
Right, right. So, again, the car size is dictated by the weight of the material that it's hauling. The short ones like this are often used to haul cement.
Yeah, that's a very dense, right, sand probably.
Right. This green one and this one in the back are actually grain hoppers.
Mm-hmm.
And this one is used to haul something else. I'm not sure. It says polymers on the side, so I'm probably some kind of industrial material. In spite of the variation in appearance, you can see this car has more flat sides. This one's a little bit more rounded, and this one's...
That's very rounded.
Very rounded. They're all basically the same type of car. So they do vary in appearance. Also, the ones with the long hatches like this are often grain cars because of the way they're loaded, whereas the ones with the little round hatches usually haul other things. So here's some more covered hoppers, and these are different from the other ones in that these all use air as part of the unloading system.
Oh, is that what they call air slide?
Yeah, this is an air slide, which is a brand name. These other two are just pressure differential hoppers, and I know this one looks kind of like a tank car, but it's not. It's a covered hopper.
You know, what's funny about this, Dan, is the one closest to the camera here, the grayish one, looks like a boxcar.
Almost.
The one in the middle looks like a tank car.
Yeah.
You know? So they could easily, if you're not paying attention to the hatches on top, because that's your spotting feature right there.
Right.
The biggest
gates
one.
At the bottom, yeah.
Right. Yeah. The gates, if you're on track side, you'd look for the gates. But looking at the models, I'm looking for hatches.
Right.
That's funny.
Another thing about covered hoppers is that even the modern ones still have roof walks. And that's because people have to get up there to open the hatches.
Oh, to access the hatches. Yeah.
Right. But they don't do it while the train's moving.
Well, I should hope not.
Yeah. So these are gondolas.
Yep.
And these are kind of like a flat car, except they have sides.
Yes.
And the main difference between these and, say, a hopper is that they don't typically have gates on the bottom to let stuff out.
Hmm. So unloading a gondola is probably a pain in the butt, huh?
Yeah, well, it depends on the load. Ones like this can be used to haul just about anything, really. Sometimes you see them full of scrap metal or...
Yeah, I've seen garbage trains with those.
Yeah, pipe loads, anything. And they usually get really beat up, too, because they're not exactly treated gently, usually, when they're being loaded and unloaded.
I would imagine there's probably a lot of shifting of the loads, which would cause the sides to get pretty banged up.
Yeah.
So, but I have a question, though. Now, I'm seeing a couple of cars there that have coal loads, and for some reason, and I just don't think about this that often, but I thought they use hoppers for coal, because don't they want to be able to get that load out the bottom or something? Or do you know what I mean? Like, I didn't realize. I mean, now that I'm thinking about it, I realize that they have, you know, coal trains that are all gondolas, but how do they unload those?
Yeah, so what they basically do is they get these to the coal plant, and then they have an army of guys with shovels, and they just empty them.
Yeah, right.
No, I'm kidding. most of these cars have a rotary coupler on one end. Usually it's the end that's marked with a color like this one.
Oh,
and they have these big rotary car dumpers, and they will run one car in it, into it at a time. And they, because they have a rotary coupler on one end, they don't even have to uncouple the train. And it takes the entire car and just flips it over
mm-hmm.
and dumps it out. As you can see, these cars don't even have any gates on the bottom. They just are, you know, have yeah. tubs. In fact, this one here is called a bathtub gondola. So
you can take a bath in it.
Yeah. So these are kind of a specialized gondola, mostly used in unit trains. Usually you don't see these individually. You'll see, you know, trains of 80 of them or more, you know, going down mm-hmm. the track.
Yeah, I could see where they wouldn't have cuts of these interspersed with other stuff because it's all, you know, they're all going to the same place for the same reason to be unloaded the exact same way.
Right. So this huge gondola is actually used for wood chips.
Oh, see, I was wondering too, and I guess that makes sense because wood chips probably wouldn't weigh that much.
Right. So I think they may use these for some other things too, but that's what they originally intended for was wood chips. So this is another type of gondola. This one is a sugar beet car.
Mm-hmm.
And these have extensions so that they can put more beets in them. And the other thing that's different about this car is that these actually have little gates on the bottom that open kind of this way
uh-huh.
to let the beets out.
So it's almost a hopper, kind of.
Yeah, but it's still classified as a gondola for some reason. So that's what it is.
And, you know, I wonder, Dan, maybe you'll know the answer to this question, because I know this is a very SP thing.
Uh-huh.
Do you know if anybody anywhere else used beet gonds like this?
I don't know if they used ones exactly like this. I think other railroads did haul sugar beets, but yeah, I don't know.
This was Southern Pacific's answer to
right.
hauling sugar beet challenge, right. whatever that is.
Right. These are also technically classified as gondolas.
Oh, really?
But they're very specialized, and these are coil steel cars.
Mm-hmm.
And they basically are a very shallow gondola with a cover on it. And the cover can be lifted off, and they have coiled steels inside. This one doesn't actually lift off the model, but this one does.
Hmm.
I don't have any steel loads in here, but what they would do is they would put the steel coils like here, and there's even sloped sides inside to keep the, because they're usually round, you know?
Right, so that it wouldn't shift, right?
Right, so they don't roll around. And then I guess the covers keep them from rusting or something, I don't know.
Well, yeah, it doesn't get exposed because
right.
steel will rust.
Right. So, and sometimes you see these cars with the covers mixed up, like they'll take the cover from some other car and put it on this one.
Mm-hmm.
So they sometimes look weird, and they're usually a lot dirtier than this. But anyway, okay, so these things are what we would call non-revenue equipment, meaning that they're not hauling loads to make money. These are maintenance of way cars.
Uh-huh.
And there's so much that could be included with maintenance of way. This is just a small example of some things you might see. There's a lot of other stuff that's very specialized that I don't have models of, so yeah, well, we're just using these.
One interesting thing as I'm looking at this is, and if you look at it, I'm looking at a specialized boxcar. I'm looking at a specialized tank car. This one closer to me on the right here is a gondola of some sort.
Right.
Right, but specialized. Right. That little black thing in the front there, I don't know what that is.
That's a scale test car. At places like grain elevators where they load those covered hoppers,
yeah.
they have scales so that they can weigh the car before and after it's loaded so they know how much grain is in it.
Oh, so this is something that weighs a specific amount always, and they're like, okay, how right. much to make sure the scale's working?
To make okay. sure the scale's calibrated. That's what this is.
Because when you said scale test, I'm thinking, what, like, but that would be a gauge test, not a scale test.
Yeah,
I was thinking to make sure that the tracks are the right width or what?
No, that's, there's certain places where they have scales to weigh freight cars, and
yeah.
they use something like this to calibrate it. This is a side dump gondola. They would usually, these things actually, this model doesn't do it, but the bed of the car will tilt this way or the other way, and one side or the other will open and the load will spill out. And then sometimes they use these for ballast.
Yeah.
This is what's called a flanger, and this is basically a piece of snow fighting equipment.
Yeah. This is another SP thing, isn't it?
This is a Southern Pacific flanger, and on SP, the flangers were mostly used for snow. Sometimes they use flangers for other things, but
Donner Pass, man.
Yeah.
They still use them.
Yeah, this is a Southern Pacific water car that would have been just used to haul water around. And then this is a Santa Fe Maintenance Away boxcar, which is basically just an old boxcar that's been repurposed to haul tools or supplies or whatnot. And there's, you know, like I said, there's all kinds of other specialized maintenance away equipment. You could do a whole show on maintenance away equipment.
Maybe we will sometime.
Maybe we will sometime. But this is just to get your feet wet. So I think we've come to the end of the train.
Somehow I knew that you were going to say that.
So these are cabooses, or in the case of the Santa Fe, way cars.
That's what I was just thinking, right?
Yeah.
See, but there's something weird going on here because these aren't used anymore, really.
No, they're not. These were used up through the 80s, basically. They made some rule change. I think it was in 86, I want to say, or somewhere around there, that allowed them to basically get rid of cabooses, and the railroads kind of phased them out.
Wasn't it having to do with the size of the crew that was necessary to run the train?
Yeah,
properly?
there were some changes. I don't know all the details, but in any case, yeah, the crew size was reduced. Most trains these days just have a 2-person crew. They just have at least a 5-person crew. And they just don't use these anymore, really. But this is an older caboose with it's made of wood. You can see the vertical.
Yeah, the paneling.
Panels. Yeah. And this one has a cupola. This is a steel caboose that has bay windows on the sides, which was a different style.
Time out for 1 second, because you just kind of glossed over that. This is a cupola. Someone watching this might not know what a cupola is.
Okay. The cupola is this raised part of the caboose, and there's actually a little raised seat in there that you can climb up into, and that allowed them to look, you know, at the train from a higher perspective. Part of the purpose of the caboose was so that somebody in the back of the train could keep an eye on it.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention that because this is for beginners and some people might not know what that was.
Right. So the bay windows on this caboose serve more or less the same purpose, except instead of being up, you're out to the side. But it's kind of the same idea. Cabooses were also one of the pieces of equipment on railroads that had the most names. They were called vans in Canada. Pennsylvania called them cabin cars. There's all kinds of names for cabooses.
That's a caboose to me.
Yeah, yeah. Unless you're a Santa Fe fan, then it's a way car. So cabooses used to often have red marker lights on the back. And since they don't use those anymore, these days you usually see something like what's on this boxcar here.
That's called an end of train device, isn't it?
Yeah. Or FRED, for flashing rear end device.
Yeah, we've talked about FREDs before, I think, on a podcast or something like that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's pretty cool, and it's neat that they've made models. Someone came up with these models of FREDs.
Yeah, so now you can model a modern train or a older train, either way. So, anyway, that was a little bit of an overview of the different kinds of freight cars. Hopefully, if you didn't know what they were for, you have a little better idea now. Now, you know, all these different car types have subcategories and special duty cars, and you know, there's all kinds of variations you could go into and make it, you know, if you really want to get in depth. Yeah. But that's a little beyond the scope of what we're doing here.
My favorites were the round hoppers that look like tank cars. I kind of know a little bit about this stuff, and I thought it was a tank the first time I saw one. So what do you think we'll be talking about next time?
Well, we can continue talking about some more equipment. Maybe we can get into some locomotives or something.
Okay. Sounds like fun.
Yeah.
So I have a question. I'm raising my hand about off camera.
Yeah.
So can I go to the bathroom now?
Yeah. Class dismissed.